Have you ever seen this woman? This is Kathleen Booth, the creator of the first assembly language. Since this first iteration of the assembly language, it has evolved a lot, but the core foundations remain the same. Assembly is the first non-mechanical programming language ever created, and for that reason it's pretty old, so people often disregard it, except for a handful of individuals who find themselves obligated to do so because of their area of expertise. But assembly should not be limited to such demographic. This will sound controversial, but I think it should be learned by every beginner as their first programming language. The reason for my belief is its authenticity. Assembly is referred to as a very low-level programming language for how it is line-to-line exactly how the computer executes instructions and interacts with the memory. Most will think that since it is so bare metal, it's insane to believe that a beginner should learn it. Though I'm 100% certain that with the right teaching, anyone can kickstart their journey with this language. Assembly will not only provide you with a deep understanding of how the actual backend behind any programming language work, but it will also push you into learning down to the electrical level of how your computer computes. And this is a very valuable thing to understand, because computer science isn't all about just pathetic lines of code.
Welcome to Look at This Shit Show. Look at this shit. What is all about? Lesbians?
For the rest of the video, I will do my best to give you this proper introduction to the assembly language, assuming you're a complete novice. Before we set up an environment and dive into assembly itself, I need to explain a couple of fundamental concepts that will serve you all along your journey. John von Neumann was a brilliant man who worked along some of the most famous geniuses of the 20th century on the Manhattan Project, which aimed at the development of nuclear weapons for the deterrence. It was initiated by the government of the United States of America. In 1945, Mr. von Neumann created the von Neumann architecture, which became a ground pillar for the computers we know today. It was just a theoretical model of computation, but over time, of course, his architecture evolved and others were invented. But it is still the mother of all systems. His model looked a lot like this. It consists of an input, an output, a central processing unit, and a memory unit. The CPU will have a control unit and an arithmetical logical unit, or ALU for short, along with registers. Now, to begin dissecting all this, the control unit of the CPU handles how the instructions should be directed on it, and the arithmetical logical unit is what executes all the logical and arithmetic operations such as logic gates, addition, and multiplication. Logic gates are circuits which take a certain number of inputs depending on the type and will output something. There are three fundamental logic gates, AND, OR, and NOT. A good way to memorize them is to use something called prepositions, which are basically statements with either a true or a false meaning. For example, let's say I take the statement "the sky is blue," which is true, and the statement "the sky is green," which is false, and use the AND gate, which takes two inputs and provided the two. It will output 0, aka false, because the statement "the sky is blue" and "the sky is green" is a false statement. The same logic applies to all the other logic gates. The OR gate takes two inputs as well and will always output true if one of them is true, because the statement "the sky is blue" or "the sky is green" is true because one of the inputs is true, for example. Now, the NOT gate only takes one input and makes the input inverse of what it is. The statement "the sky is not green" will be true, for example. A bit is the smallest unit of data you will find in your computer. It is either 0 or 1, and this is what you pass to logic gates. Usually under the form of a list of bits, aka decimal numbers, because fundamentally a decimal number in a computer is just a series of bits. There's also the registers, which are small units of architecture size, very fast storage. A 64-bit CPU would have 64-bit registers and a 32-bit registers. There are different of those labeled with different names by the assembly language, but we'll get to see that later. After this, the memory unit is what most know as the random access memory, or RAM for short. The CPU and the memory unit are connected through something called a bus. Alright, right before we start programming assembly, we will need to learn some basics about the language and programming in general. Every line of code in assembly is called an instruction, and intuitively so. And each one of these instructions can be dumbed down with two terms. The left part of it, which represents the instruction itself, is called an opcode. It is usually a mnemonic which looks something like add, which is for addition, or sub, which is for subtraction. The right part on the other end represents the arguments passed to these opcodes and is called the operands. There are a couple of arithmetic instructions you can use utilize in assembly. Let's say I want to add two numbers using add. You have to understand that this instruction will add two operands, but store the result in the first one. So the first operand you pass to this add or any other similar arithmetic operation has to be a memory location or a register. The code to add 5 with 5 would look something like this. I first use an instruction called move, which just moves the second operand you pass inside the first one by passing Rx as the location to store it, which is a 64-bit register commonly used for such operations, just as a convention. Its official name is the accumulator. Then I use values add by passing rx as the first operand and 5 as the second. In the end, if we looked inside of rx, we will find a value 10. Now, the other arithmetic instructions behave the same way. Sub will subtract the first operand with the second one and store the result in the first one. Mul will multiply the first with the second and store in the first. And div will do the same thing but divide. The stack is a last in first style data structure, which means that the last element to be added will be the first one to be removed on demand. It is for that reason used by programs to save memory temporarily because of the limited amount of registers there are. There are two main instructions in assembly to interact with the stack, push and pop. Push will add an element at the top of the stack and will decrease the stack pointer based on the size of this element, and which is a register that it has the name RAX for 64 bits, and pop will decrease the stack pointer and store the value that there was there in the operand that was provided. This sounds weird, but yes, the stack grows downwards within the stack frame of a function. Basically, when you call a function, the stack allocates a space for it, which is what we call the stack frame, and data is pushing it downwards towards the smaller addresses. Now, like any programming language, assembly allows you to make conditions and jump around depending on their state. At the base, there is jump instruction, which will just set the instruction pointer, which is a register which points to the current instruction, to point to a new location, thus altering the flow of execution. But when it comes to comparing values, there is only one instruction, compare or CMP. This instruction will check a lot of conditions on the values provided and store the result of each one of those conditions in tiny registers called flags. Then, by calling some variations of the jump instruction, which checks those flags depending on the instruction, it will jump or not. There are a lot of existing conditional jumps, but for the sake of time, I will only mention some of them. JE aka jump if equal, JZ aka jump if 0, and every conditional jump has a variation of not, like JE, which has J and E aka jump if not equal. There's also JB aka jump if below, JB aka jump if below or equal, and JG aka jump if greater. There's a lot of others, but this will do just fine for now. Just like I explained earlier, there are base logic gates like AND, NOT, and OR. And in assembly, they work the same way as I explained. Only difference is rather than just passing a single bit, you pass a whole number, which is just a series of bits. And the logic is applied to each one of those bits. Let's say I pass two operands, 8 and 16, to the instruction AND. It would be like passing 1000 and 10000, which are 8 and 16 on their binary format. The output would be just 0, because as I explained, AND gate requires two of the inputs to be 1, aka true, for the output to be 1, otherwise it's just 0. Now, the same thing applies to the NOT and the OR logic gate, but we're not done here. While there are only three fundamental logic gates, you can combine them together to create new ones that behave differently. An example of this is the combination of the AND and the NOT gate, which produces the NAND gate, which will do the inverse of the AND gate, that is, return 0 if both statements are true and 1 otherwise. Here's a list of all the other logic gates you might want to take a look at, but I won't be describing them here. Now, getting to programming assembly, it has two main flavors, AT&T and the Intel syntax. The one we will focus on is the Intel syntax, simply because it is more widely used and looks better. In order to start assembling some programs, we'll use something called WSL for the Windows users. Now, if you're on Linux, don't worry, the process is pretty much the same at the exception of WSL. The first thing we'll do is open the Turn Windows Features On or Off dialog by typing it in our search bar. Then scroll to Windows Subsystem for Linux and check if it wasn't. And if it wasn't, you will need to restart your system in order to proceed. Now, open the Microsoft Store, search Debian and install it. I advise you to search for Terminal 2 and install it. When you will open Debian Terminal, it will ask you to create a user, so just do so. After doing all that, inside of the Debian Terminal, type sudo apt update and sudo apt upgrade. You will need to insert a password you assigned to the user you made earlier though. After that, type sudo apt install vim, nasm, gcc, multilib. Now that the environment is set up, we will begin by typing in the Debian Terminal vim main.s. Vim is a text editor that is quite confusing for some beginners, so just to give a hand, I'll explain some of the basics of using it. When you first open it with a file, you are in visual mode in which you cannot type anything, but still interact with the text. In order to enter hidden mode and be able to type, you need to press I, then type whatever. Then to go back in visual mode, type escape. And from there, in order to save the content, just type colon, and at the bottom of the screen, characters will appear. Now type W, which will write the modifications to the file, and press enter. Now to exit, type colon again, and type Q, which will quit Vim. But Q-tip, instead of just writing Q, type W in Q, which is literally writing quit. Good, now you should be able to use Vim on your own and maybe learn all the keybinds if you feel like it. Now type vim main.s again and type dd to remove all the lines you might have wrote if you did what I said. Now you can go in insert mode and we will begin writing our first assembly program. We will first type section.txt, which defines the text section where all the code will be executed. Click on the card at the top right corner to view my video on the subject. Then type global underscore start, which will define a symbol for the entry point of the program. Now after typing underscore start colon, we will be able to write some instructions. Now at the very top of of the file, we will add extern printf and extern exit, which will define the symbols of the functions which we will link later. Now the first thing we'll do is call exit at the end of the program so it ends properly by simply moving our 0 and rx, which will hold the exit code, and then do call exit, which will call the exit function. Just so you can get a better idea of how assembly works, we'll create user's code. First we'll move the value 5 inside of rex register, then check if rex has the value 4 by executing compare rex 4, and check if it is equal by executing g test, which will jump to the label test if it is equal to 4. So now we have to define the label test right under it. So if it isn't equal, it will just keep executing, otherwise it will jump to test. Right before the exit call, we'll add the label exit and do a jump exit if the condition was not met. Alright, now we will print text to the console depending on the state of the conditions. To do so, right before the jump exit, we'll call printf and move the arguments we need to pass using registers, because in 64 bits, the default C calling convention forces us to use the following registers in order: RDI, RSI, RDX, RCX, R8, and R9. Any more arguments will need to be pushed on the stack. Though these calling conventions can sometimes vary since there are more than one calling convention, but this is a subject for another video. In the case of printf, we'll only use three registers. The first one holds the format, which specifies what value we want to print, the second the string, and the third we'll ignore for now since it is only used for floating points. Alright, now we'll execute move RDI failure message, then move RSI FMT, then move RX0, and finally call printf. Just copy the lines of code we just made and paste them under the test label and change the failure message to success message. Now at the very end of the file, we'll create a data section and add two strings in it. The first one is failure message, and add the keyword DB after it, which will tell NASM that our string uses byte list, and pass the message RX was not equal to 4. Then copy and paste and change the name to success message and change the string to RX was equal to 4. Finally, we will add another string of the name FMT and add the value %s, which means string format. See the printf function documentation for more information about the formats. Also, don't forget to add 10,0 at the end of the strings to add a new line and an old termination character, and only add the termination character to the FMT. Now write in quit vim, and in order to build and run our program, we will first type nasm-fl64-obey.od main.s, and after that ld-dynamic-linker/lib64/ld-linux-x86-64.so.2-o main-lc-main.o. Now we can run the program by typing .main. I wanted to thank El Sorze de la Mula, Oscar, iDrive, SuperCookie, Quinn, and all the others for supporting me on my Patreon. Your support makes it possible for me to make better content for everyone. If you want to help me grow for free, you can do it by simply subscribing to my channel and liking this video. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.